So let's discuss the performance of multithreading and how can it be better than simply running things one at a time. So if we have a processor with no multithreading support, then this is how two threads might run. These are cycles going in this direction. So each notch here is a cycle, and we have four instructions that can execute in this cycle. So this is what might happen. A green thread might be using this and this slot in this cycle, and the other two issue slots are not used because the processor has no ready instructions to dispatch to execution in this cycle. Let's say there is a data dependence, so next cycle, one instruction can wake up, and then let's say that in the next cycle we can have three instructions go, but then let's say that all of the instructions are now waiting for something to happen, so let's say for a few cycles we don't get much happening, then when it happens we get to execute, let's say, all four, and then maybe another cycle with two, etc. So things can be like this, basically. Much of the time we are running with a less than fully utilized processor pipeline. Let's say that at this point we get an interrupt, and because there is another thread that is ready to run, we now get many cycles of the operating system doing its thing. So it's also going to utilize the pipeline in some way, but it spends many cycles basically figuring out which thread to run next. Eventually it decides that it's going to be the blue thread and begins executing instructions from that thread on the processor. So this is where we return from the interrupt and start executing a new thread, because let's say we have these two threads ready to go. So the blue thread, in a similar way, will be using the processor partially. Let's say it has a level one miss, takes a while to get the thing from level two. Meanwhile, maybe it's able to do something for a while, but eventually runs out of things to do, and then, for example, starts doing something again, and let's say this whole cycle is used. So this is what might happen in a processor with no multithreading support. In that case, really, the overhead that you created by having to switch between threads is probably larger than the gains we are getting from running them. We were better off just running a single thread that does the work of both of these threads. So really, a single processor with no multithreading is capable of doing this with a good operating system, not because it's better for performance to break work into multiple threads, but because we want to be able to simultaneously run several applications and make progress in them, so that, for example, if you're playing games and playing music at the same time, we alternate between the game and the music player fast enough for you to not be able to tell that they're really executing one at a time on your one core. If we have a chip multiprocessor, we get to do something like this. Now we have two cores, each of which pretty much gets to execute one thread. So it's faster, of course, than this, and we can benefit truly from being able to write multi-threaded programs, but you have to have two cores for it. So the cost is about twice the cost of a single core here. So with fine-grained multi-threading, what we have is really one core, but with separate sets of registers for these threads and some scheduling logic. With fine-grained multithreading, every cycle we can switch between threads. So what happens is, the green thread gets exactly the same behavior in the first cycle. In the second cycle, we do the blue thread. So we get the behavior of its first cycle here. Then we do some of the work from the green thread again. Then from the blue thread. Third cycle of the green thread. Third cycle of the blue thread. And now we would be running the green thread, except that there is nothing to run there. But what happens is the blue thread has something to do, so we spend another cycle on the blue thread, and then the green thread is still somewhere here. There is nothing ready to run, but these operations are going on. So the blue thread gets one more cycle here. At this point, the blue thread has nothing to do, but the green one now has something to do. So we end up doing the work of the green thread, and then for another cycle. Then let's say neither of the threads can do something, but then the blue thread is able to do this because it's been three cycles since here. And then again. And as you can see, we get done faster than here because we are able to eliminate some of the cycles where we were not able to do anything. So fine-grained multithreading benefits from the fact that when there is a long period of idleness in one thread, for example, due to a cache miss, you might be able to run still instructions from the other thread. And finally, let's see what happens in SMT. In SMT, we are able to mix instructions from different threads in the same cycle. So what we will get is the green one gets this. The blue one also wants to use the bottom slot, and let's say that there is a unit there, for example, the load unit that you have to use here, but we can still run this in the same cycle. Next cycle, the green thread does this. The blue one wants to now do this, this, and this, and we can, let's say, do these two. But let's say there is a dependence from this to this, so we can only do this one. Next cycle, the green thread can do this. And from the blue thread, we can maybe do this instruction or maybe not. So let's say we can't, because maybe this one depends also on the one that we haven't done or the next one. Now, however, there is some period of idleness in the green thread, and now the blue thread gets to make up for missing out on some things. So it's able to maybe do this and this dependent instruction. And at this point, the green thread is ready to run something. So we can choose whether to run the green or the blue one. Let's say that the green thread has a higher priority, so we always try to do instructions from the green thread and only fill the gaps with the blue ones. Now we've done this. Next cycle, we still do whatever we can from the green thread. We now can do this. And now we only have the blue thread left to do. If the green thread has more stuff to do, we can do this. So as you can see, with SMT, we get to populate unused slots in what would otherwise be a full speed execution of the green thread, so that the blue thread gets to make progress while the green thread really is not suffering from it. And we can do that for more than just two threads. So for example, if we had four threads, we might be able to actually do another thread at a slightly slower pace than blue while we are also doing this. So with SMT, what we are doing, we are really using underutilized issue slots in our out-of-order superscalar processor. The hardware cost to do this is very small. Our fetch stage needs to be slightly more complicated to allow us to fetch from one or the other PC. And our register file needs to be slightly more complicated, because really there are now two sets of architectural registers. But other than that, the whole complicated out-of-order engine stays the same. So let's say this is going to cost us something like 5% of the cost of a no multithreaded processor. This here, again, after we do register renaming and everything else, the processor scheduler stays just the same. We just need to put instructions from multiple threads in the instruction window so that they could be scheduled from there. And now also when we commit, we have to figure out which instruction belongs to which commit and so on. So the cost is slightly larger than fine-grained, but still not very large, because again, most of the complicated reservation stations and execution units and everything else stays pretty much unmodified. So this is going to have performance that is maybe very close to a CMP. Two threads here, two threads here, maybe making almost as much progress, but at a very small fraction of this cost.